Rwanda's national colors of blue, green, and yellow light up the capital, giving Kigali a festive look as the $300 million US dollars Kigali Convention Center stands out in the city's impressive skyline. Not only is it East Africa's biggest convention center, but it also represents something much bigger. It is a perfect exemplification of prosperity and national pride for a country that has sprung back from a devastating genocide in 1994, where almost 1 million people lost their lives, leaving a debris of economic ruin. Today, this small, hilly and landlocked nation is not just punching above her weight, she's emerged as a model of economic development, termed by some as a third world country, with first world indicators. Rwanda stands out for many good things. This country goes toe-to-toe with some of the world's most developed nations in categories such as ease of doing business and the corruption index. If you'd like to have some better understanding of Africa, start now by subscribing and hit the little red bell on the side to get notified every time we post. Welcome to Reason Africa. Despite harrowing memories of the 1994 ethnic cleansing, Rwanda has witnessed a remarkable economic transformation in recent years and has become one of the most successful knowledge-based economies on the African continent. Its achievements are often described as nothing short of miraculous. It has become the country to look out for in terms of investment opportunities, value for money, and economic growth, so much so that it is touted as being on the fast lane to become a first world country. To definitively say this, we must first look to understand the meaning of first world and third world countries. The origin of the terms is usually credited to French demographer Alfred Sauvy, who used the terms in a 1952 article entitled Three Worlds, One Planet. In the original context, first world included the United States and its capitalist allies, member states of NATO, in places such as Western Europe, Japan, and Australia. The second world consisted of the communist Soviet Union and its Eastern European neighbors. The third world, meanwhile, encompassed all the other countries that were not actively aligned with either side in the Cold War. These were often impoverished countries that included nearly all nations of Africa, the Middle East, Latin America, and Asia. Today, the terms have evolved. Third world countries are also referred to as low and middle income countries, while first world countries could also be referred as more developed countries or MDCs. Of the 54 African countries, about 19 are represented on the world's poorest list. Three factors determine whether or not a country makes the cut to be classified as a first world country: the gross domestic product and economic stability, political stability, and data from the Human Development Index are also taken into consideration. The first factor to consider in Rwanda's rapid transformation: GDP and economic stability. Rwanda does not rank among the richest countries in Africa, but there's a reason why this tiny East African nation has become Africa's poster child for progress. In the year 2000, the government established Vision 2020, a long-term development strategy with the main objective to transform Rwanda into a middle-income country by 2020, based on a thriving private sector. Since then, the Rwandan economy has been growing steadily at 7% every year, earning a reputation as one of Africa's fastest growing economies. The government has undertaken policies to improve competitiveness, diversify food production, promote exports, and contain imports. Thanks to this growth, Rwanda has been able to pull at least 1 million citizens out of poverty between 2000 and 2015, making it one of the few African nations on track to achieving the UN-backed Sustainable Development Goals. The share of people classified as poor has fallen by 7 percentage points since 2011 to 38% in 2017. The country's economy is projected to grow at 7.8% in 2019 and 8% in 2020, supported by export growth resulting from continued public investments such as the Busegera Airport, targeting to handle 1.7 million passengers every year and will be later upgraded to accommodate 4.5 million passengers annually, thereby making Rwanda an important aviation hub and a fierce rival to many of Africa's premier airports and carriers like Ethiopian Airlines, South African, and Kenya Airways. The airline plans to fly to 31 destinations all across Africa. Other planned routes include long-haul destinations such as New York, Tel Aviv, and Guangzhou. Benchmarking on the growth strategy of successful airlines like Emirates, Singapore, and Qatar, Rwanda is keen on aviation's growing significance as a major engine of economic development and its far-reaching contributions to other industries as a catalyst for economic activity. Rwanda's GDP per capita in 1994 was $146. In 2017, it stood at $774 and is projected to have reached around $1,000 by the end of 2020. According to the International Monetary Fund, a whopping 82% jump in GDP per capita. Very few countries can boast of such rapid growth. The country has also reduced reliance on foreign aid and currently domestically funds about 84% of the budget, up from about 36% 2 decades ago. Studies have shown that nations that make serious economic progress focus on growing the average income of their citizens. For example, Japan focused on this between 1950 and 1972 and doubled its GDP per capita. The second factor to consider a country as first world is political stability. It's not easy to talk about Rwanda without talking about President Paul Kagame. His leadership style has played a major role in terms of the political stability the country is enjoying. Kagame previously commanded the rebel force that ended the 1994 genocide. He was considered Rwanda's de facto leader when he served as Vice President and Minister of Defense from 1994 to the year 2000. He has been widely described as the most impressive and among the most repressive African leaders, which begs the question, is Rwanda's Paul Kagame a strongman, a technocrat, or a little bit of both? And how has he contributed to Rwanda's stability? Many African economies are known for mining natural resources or being agrarian in nature. Kagame chose to take Rwanda on a different path by choosing to diversify exports and sources of revenue, making services the country's linchpin earner. Thanks to investment in both soft and hard infrastructure, such as the State of Art Convention Center in 2018, the International Congress and Convention Association ranked Kigali as the third most popular conference and event destination on the continent after Cape Town in South Africa and Casablanca of Morocco. By 2020, Rwanda is projected to double its revenue from conference tourism, and investors have been paying attention. Marriott, Radisson Blue, Park Inn, Serena, among others, are set to increase investments and create thousands of jobs in the countries, promising hospitality industry. Kagame's can-do mindset has put Rwanda on a growth trajectory thanks to the Made in Rwanda strategy in a bid to promote consumption of locally produced goods as well as stabilize the local currency. One notable sector to benefit from this is tech. Two Made in Rwanda smartphones are the latest feather in the cap for Rwanda. The phones, called Mara X and Mara Z, are the first Made in Africa models. While smartphones are assembled in other African nations like Egypt, Algeria, Kenya, and South Africa, those companies all import the components. In Rwanda, they manufacture the phones from the motherboards to the packaging, all done on Rwandan soil. In order to enhance medical care across the country, under the stewardship of Kagame, Rwanda recently started a drone delivery service which will help in the transportation of medical supplies in far-flung areas of the nation in efforts to revolutionize the country's medical sector. The Rwandan leader is big on intra-African trade and regional integration in the six-member East African community to foster a regional market of over 200 million citizens. In 2018, Kagame took on US President Donald Trump over trade. He slapped a ban on importation of used clothes from the United States, pitting the world's largest economy against Rwanda. Kagame stuck to his guns, saying the move will protect Rwanda's local garment industry he knows can create thousands of jobs locally. A darling of the development community, critics say that while the regime has maintained peace and economic growth, it has also suppressed political dissidents through pervasive surveillance, intimidation, and suspected assassinations. However, scholars have also shown that the fast-growing East Asian tigers benefited from a form of state-directed capitalism. Scholars have also coined the term Kagamenomics in a bid to analyze this apparent paradox of strongmanship in relation to development. The third factor to consider when judging a first-world country is the Human Development Index. Rwanda is still a work in progress, but when you look at where the country has been, where it is now, and the record-setting time it has taken to get there, the nation is definitely on the fast lane for success. According to the 2019 World Bank Doing Business Index, Rwanda is the 29th easiest place to do business in the world, the only low-income country in the top 30, beating far richer countries like the Netherlands, which ranked number 36, Switzerland ranked number 38, and Italy, which posted number 51. The most recent Corruption Perception Index by Transparency International ranked Rwanda the third least corrupt country on the African continent, only behind the Seychelles and Botswana, which are some of Africa's richest countries according to the gross national income. Since 1994, Rwanda has made resounding progress. Life expectancy has risen from 48 years to 66 years. The mortality rate for children dropped from 152 per 1,000 live births to 42. And its parliament leads the world in female representation, with 64% of its seats held by women. Also, four of the nation's seven Supreme Court justices are women, including the Deputy Chief Justice. These three factors, GDP, political stability, and Human Development Index, however, have been under debate and controversy for a long time. There is an argument to be made that several first world countries also have poverty-stricken regions, areas with conditions comparable to those used to describe third world countries. Basically, they are living in a first world with third world standards, or the complete reverse of people living in a third world with first world standards. Rwanda is a classic example. There are many facets of growth where Rwanda can draw inspiration and benchmark with Singapore to bolster economic growth. Time frames matter when attempting to understand how long it takes to make the transition. Examining the economic trajectory of some countries between 1960 and 2020 suggests that it can take about 40 to 50 years to turn a country from third world to first world. Though Rwanda is making an all-out concerted effort to turn into another Singapore through following Singapore's footsteps, some challenges lay ahead. Critics argue that Rwanda is lacking some of Singapore's advantages and may take longer to replicate Singapore's success. Singapore has access to the sea with the world's busiest port. Rwanda is landlocked. Singapore has one of the world's best education systems. Rwanda is currently transitioning from an agrarian population to a knowledge-based economic system. Singapore is in a stable political neighborhood, while Rwanda's neighborhood faces volatile regional politics. Despite the myriad of challenges, Rwanda's indicators are still beyond impressive. Singapore went from being a third world country to a first world country in just 60 years. As a matter of fact, the country's GDP grew from $700 million in the 1960s to $325 billion today. Rwanda, on the other hand, has taken great strides just 25 years since the genocide. Of course, Rwanda, an $8.4 billion economy, is still far from the prize of becoming a most developed country, but it is definitely ticking all the right boxes. With sustained economic growth, Rwanda undoubtedly is on the fast lane to be one of Africa's first countries to transition into a first world country. If you enjoyed this and other Raising Africa videos, please consider supporting the channel on Patreon. The link is in the description. Every dollar contributed over there goes right into creating more quality content on a more consistent basis. Thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time. See